You guys, man, it's good to see you. I'm glad you're here. We're going to see how this works out today. You know, first thing, my notes are just kind of like all over the place because God's been speaking a lot to me this week. And I try to get them in order, and I'm still trying to get it in order. So however it comes out, it's definitely not me. It's going to be definitely, you know, from the Lord. First thing I want to tell you is I've been talking about the true pattern for the church, okay? How God had originally set it up and how it's concealed in the Old Covenant. And I've been talking about to you guys about how it's all about a marriage.
Yeah.
From the beginning, from Genesis to Revelations. I don't care how you look at it, the gospel is actually a wedding invitation. That's what it means, literally. You know, you can accept it or reject it. It's totally up to you. If we just go back to the very beginning, it started with a marriage, Adam and Eve, and ends with a marriage. The bridegroom and the bride, the second man, Adam and us. And everything in between, the covenant, God married the children of Israel at Mount Sinai under the hoopah, the mountain. They was down low. He gave them a ketubah, which is a wedding contract. God didn't give them law, he gave them Torah. Torah means direction, instruction, and guidance in righteousness. Yes, it was his law. In Deuteronomy 28, it says, if you do this, then I will do this. If you do this, then I will do this. But if you don't do this, then this is what's going to happen.
Yeah.
And if we get in between every story that's in there, with Solomon, it was all about brides, right? With Ruth, it was about Boaz.
Yeah.
With Hosea, it was about an unfaithful bride.
Yeah.
You know, Jesus is looking for a bride. The marriage covenant that Jesus died for, it's because the bridegroom is looking for a bride. If we go back and we look at Abraham and Isaac, Abraham sent out Eliezer, his lead servant of his house, whose name means helper, to go get a bride for his son, Isaac.
That's right.
Right? The Bible says in Romans 8 that the Spirit is our helper.
Yeah.
The Spirit right now is looking for a bride for his son.
That's right.
For God's son. No matter where we go to in the Bible, it's all about a wedding. It's all about us serving. The Levites in the house of God in the temple, the reason they were called Levites is because it's derived from the word taken straight from the marriage. These two shall be joined and become one flesh. Right? And what God has brought together, let no man put asunder. The word joined, Levite, means joined. That's why God, in the temple, they were Levites. Levi means joined. God had joined himself, and the priest, the Levites, worked in God's house. That's why the bride works in God's house today. It's all about a marriage. So I want to start by bringing you back. God, from the very beginning, has laid out a pattern for his church, and we can see it. You know, in all kind of places. But the first thing I've been telling you guys that I wanted to start, what God had put in my heart was the tabernacle. If we look at this tabernacle, you know, set up in the wilderness, it was in the shape of a cross. We know it's, you know, a picture of Christ coming and dying for you and me. It traveled for 40 years in the shape of a cross through the wilderness. We know it's all about a temple, and it's a tabernacle, and it's all about Christ and the sacrifice and what he's done. So I just want to connect a few dots for you if you don't know. This tabernacle is in the shape of a cross, remember, right? So if I took that cross right there and laid that cross down right here on this altar of incense, right? This would be, you know, about where the center. And a tail would extend out here, right?
Right.
Right. So this would be where the feet is of the man. A tabernacle is a man. Jesus, the Word became flesh and, you know, dwelt among us. He tabernacled among us. So the tabernacle is symbolic to a man, right? If we go in Revelations, we'll see these two pieces represent the gospel. The gospel represent your feet. How beautiful are the feet of those that preach the gospel, right? What is the gospel? It's the good news. What is the good news? That Jesus died, the altar, and the labor. He rose again. Repentance and baptism. That's what's on the outside. That's why in the book of Revelation, you see, when you open up, John is caught up into heaven, right? And when he just starts describing Jesus, right? He tells you what he looks like. And when he gets down to his feet, He says his feet was as burned as brass in a furnace. That's an altar. Wow. And his voice was as the voice of many waters. Revelations 1:15. That's an altar and a laver. So what I want to do is, before we go anywhere, the Lord said that he wanted me to set up the pieces within you, because you are a tabernacle. It's important that you understand what an altar is and what a laver is before we can get to the lampstand, the showbread table, the altar of incense. No worship out here. The only way, when you come in, when you get a realization of what this is, that the Bible says that only those that worship me will worship me in spirit and in truth. It's not till you come unto a divine revelation and understanding, you know, of what Christ actually done for you and me, that you can truly worship him. Because anything else will not be accepted. Right? And the highest form of worship is obedience.
Yeah, sure.
The highest form of worship. Not what we just did, but it's when you're doing that, it's when you get a real realization of what it's really, all about. Watch this right here. I'm going to connect the songs with you first. I didn't tell my brother or talk to him about anything, but when the Spirit is moving, it'll tell you. I always look for it through, you know, through worship to see what the Spirit is saying. Right? Don't talk to the worship team. I don't tell them, hey, I'm preaching this. This is what I want you to sing. The first song they sing is Holy Fire, Burn Away. That's an altar. Right?
I'm sorry.
It's all right. Holy Fire, Burn Away.
Jesus calling.
That's all right. It's my mom. We're going to forgive her. If it was anybody else, it would be in the fire squad. So the first song he sings is about Holy Fire, Burn Away, right? So the first place that God leads us this morning is to the altar, the very thing that we're going to talk about, right? The next song he sings is With All My Heart. Now, do you have, brother, can you put that song up that he sang, the second song, With All My Heart, Down at Your Feet? What was that song, brother? Down at Your Feet? Pull that up. There you go, perfect. Wow. Let's make the connection right there. There's the gospel of peace, the feet of Jesus, the altar and the laver. What is she doing? Washing them with her tears. There's the altar and the laver right in front of us. In true worship, when you realize and you get it and you understand it, man, it's when everything really begins to open up. Then he sings, in that song, it says, down at your feet, I will worship you for all that you have done. Now, check this out. This is what the message is all about today. Because you really don't get it. You really don't understand until you get a realization of what this is. Right? This piece of furniture makes everything behind me holy. Without this one piece of furniture, what we would think that the ark is more important, or the lampstand that's actually what's on the inside. No, this piece is the only piece that touched every other piece. This piece sanctified everything that you see behind me, including the priest, the tabernacle, the pieces, the furniture, and everything was touched by this. And it says, and whatever it touched, or whatever touches it, is sanctified and holy. Son. This is his feet.
Wow.
Do you know why the altar was raised up 5 feet? It was 7.5 by 7.5, raised up 5 feet. Because that's how high Jesus was raised up. And when you came to him, you come to his feet. They're right here. Touch them.
Woo.
Sanctify. Wow. Until you can get an understanding of what actually happened within you. It's not a mere just walking. God told me last week when I taught about the altar and the laver, in the midst of me talking about the altar and the laver, he had me come across something. The word sacrifice. And he said, you really won't understand what this altar, you could tell me this altar is where Jesus died and this represents baptism. And that's good. And that's exactly right. But do you get it? Do you know what a sacrifice truly is? What is a sacrifice? And what is not a sacrifice? What is accepted here and what is not accepted here? There's a lot of things that are brought before God and offered to God. Not all the sacrifices that was placed on here, the blood of all the sacrifices that came to this altar, went into the holy place.
Right.
Not all of them did.
Right.
It was only the perfect. It was only sacrifices that was given out of love.
Amen. Yeah.
If we're going to build the house of God, God said, it's got to be done with love from the heart, free willingly.
Right.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yes.
That's how he built the tabernacle of Moses. That's how he built the temple. That's how he built the church.
Right.
Now let's set the scene. Because we don't get it where we live. Every day Jesus is, you know, in the temple. And the temple scene. What is the temple scene? Well, right now, I would be walking in blood everywhere. There'd be blood all over me. There would be blood everywhere. That's why in Solomon's temple, there was holes where they washed the blood down. Every time that Jesus ministered, went into the temple, there's blood and guts and flesh and heads and everything all over the place. Why? Because people are sacrificing every day. But we don't get it. We're watching every single day. Jesus is teaching. They see, they know, they understand. Tie them to the horns of the altar. By a rope, we're going to see it. Place your hand on his head. The priest is there to assist you. Cut its throat. Bleed it down. Don't remove your hand until he hits the ground and the innocence is transferred. Now, take your lamb and go clean it. Remove the flesh. Gut it. Do whatever you got to do and bring back the best parts.
Right.
Who did it? They did it.
Yeah.
The priests were there to assist you. Why do you think people are in the front? They get lined up at the altar. Does anybody need prayer? They are assisting in the house of God to come to the altar, place of death. And everything that gets on this, from the praise and worship team to the pastor, is supposed to be dead.
Right.
You know how much sacrifice, you know how much sacrificing that is going on this altar from people that God doesn't accept because they're not dead. What is a true sacrifice? So the temple scene is set. How would you like to? Jesus knew full well what was going to happen to him. How did he do it? How did he know? He saw it every day. He's the Lamb. He watched them ripping. He had to himself bring a lamb until the age of 30. He was that lamb. Every year, he brought a lamb. Yes, Jesus put his hand on a head. Killed the lamb. He had to. He had to fulfill the law. He had to take it to an altar, tear its heart off, knowing good and well they would be ripping his heart off. What carried him to the altar? Love. The only thing, the only sacrifice that would be accepted. the only sacrifice. That's why God is going to build his house on this rock. What is the rock? It's an altar. He's the chief cornerstone. Watch this. Upon whoever falls on this altar, on this rock, altars were made of stone, shall be saved. But whomever this altar, this rock falls upon, will be crushed. It's okay to know that's an altar and that's a laver. You can know it's made of brass, which represents suffering and judgment. You can know why God elevated it, because Christ would be elevated. You can know why it's made of brass and God had Moses make a brazen serpent that whoever was bit by the snake, now when they look to the serpent, they would be healed. Is that crazy?
Yeah.
Why a serpent? Because a serpent is in the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. It represents the law. And the law bit them and caused death. But if you look deep inside of it, the very thing that brought death now brings life. What? Be as wise as a serpent. That's the old covenant. And as harmless as a dove, that's the new covenant, the Spirit. You can't have one without the other. Brass, a brazen altar, and a brazen laver, made of the looking glasses of the women, so that when you peer into it, the Word will show you a reflection of who you are, really. That's why God judges the heart of the man. That's why when God said, let them build my house, let it be from their heart. Only God can judge the hearts of men. This is where they would come into the temple and Jesus would be teaching. They're doing sacrificing. This is the doors of the temple. And out of the doors of the temple were these big money horns. They called them horns that was in the temple. And they would walk up like this. The Pharisees, the Sadducees, the rich, they like to have a lot of change in their pocket. They would take it out and they would cast it into the horn and make all kind of noise. They wanted the recognition. Look what I'm giving. And while he's there sitting in Solomon's colonnade, because that's where the horns were, this little woman comes in, pulls out two mites, and you don't even hear them go in. And Jesus said, who's given more? Number one, they've given out of their riches. There was no sacrifice. But she gave all. That was a sacrifice. Why? Because she loved. That was accepted. This over here, that was rejected, was not accepted. How much do we offer God? I'm not talking about money. How much do we offer God out of our maybe not being our best? Maybe it's, you know, somewhere towards, you know, I might be able to fit him in on a Saturday or Sunday. Or whenever you go to church, you can go to church whatever day you want. We have church every day. When two or more gather, there he is in the midst. Let me tell you something. Until you understand what this is, you won't sell out. We talk about it, but we don't understand it. I'm going to give you an understanding of that today. Check this out. A true sacrifice. First, I want to... The Lord told me about building these pieces in the people. And after I talked about the altar and the laver and showed many altars and lavers in the Bible. Here's another one for you, Ephesians 5. Husbands. Watch this. Here's a marriage. Love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. That's an altar. And washed her by the washing of the regeneration of the word. That's a laver. Egypt was an altar. The Red Sea was a laver. Right? Moses was commanded by God, build an altar at the mountain, the foot of the mount. That's an altar. The rock of Horeb split. That's a laver. The Jordan River, 12 stones at the bottom, that's an altar. Water above, that's a laver. Solomon's Temple, 12 bulls, brazen bulls supporting 10,000 bats. That's an altar. 12 on top, that's a laver. Did you know that Satan has an altar? In a laver, in a lampstand, in a showbread table, in an altar of incense, in an ark. Did you know that? Are you crazy? I was riding home the day before yesterday. The Lord began to speak to me. And he showed me Jesus standing in the Jordan on an altar in a laver. This is eastward to the wilderness. This is westward back to God. Eastward means to go away from God. Westward means to come back in his presence. They faced westward, now I know this is south, to worship God, to put the sun at their back, because sun worship is something that they did back then. We worship the true sun, the one that sits on the throne. So check this out. Jesus, we see him in the Jordan. He's standing on 12 stones. John baptizes him. He's 30 years old, Luke chapter 3. The Holy Spirit comes down and fills him. And the Spirit driveth him eastward into the wilderness, not westward. Why? This altar and this laver is the 12 stones and the water of the Jordan that Joshua set up for Jesus to come and begin his ministry. 30 years old. That's when a priest came in to serve. Why did the Spirit take him eastward into the wilderness? It says he took him into the wilderness for 40 days. Watch this. He goes in the wilderness. 40 represents the death to the flesh. There's got to be a removal of the flesh. And then Lucifer, the light bearer, comes to him and says, turn these stones into bread, if thou be the Son of God. Man, Jesus quotes to him, after being in the wilderness for 40 days, makes a direct connection for you and me. He says, Satan, light bearer. It says in Deuteronomy chapter 8, he quotes the scripture to him. He says, I know you know, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word. But watch, Deuteronomy 8. He quoted to him Deuteronomy 8:3. Jesus now in the wilderness for 40 days, being tempted by Satan. Now, you know what the verse above it says? Deuteronomy 8, verse 2. And thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness, to humble thee, to test thee, to know what was truly in your heart. And he humbled thee, verse 3. Jesus quotes this to him. He directly, Jesus takes you and me directly from his 40 days in the wilderness, showing us it's symbolic to the 40 years of the children of Israel, where they had to be tested. He also had to be tested. In fact, it says that Jesus learned obedience through what he suffered.
Yes.
You can't learn obedience if you don't suffer. Because everything is always good. You have to go through a little something before you can offer it to him. A real sacrifice will cost you.
Yeah.
Everything. Everything.
Yeah.
Nothing else would be accepted. I don't care how many offerings are thrown in the basket. I don't care how much you do. If you don't get this, you don't get nothing else. You don't get past this. And he humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger. That means he allowed you to hunger. That means he took the food away to see if you're going to be obedient, to really see what's in your heart. Who did that? God did. To see if you really trust him. The highest form of worship is to be obedient. Nothing surpasses. Saul, it's better to be obedient than to sacrifice. The sacrifice is your offering to the Lord, Saul. Cost you nothing. Sacrifice is cost. And the Bible says in Romans 12, lay down your life. A living sacrifice. What is Paul connecting? The altar. Go back and read Romans 12 now. And in doing so, at the end of Romans 12, he says, love your enemy. Love. In doing so, you heap coals.
That's right.
What coals? What is he talking about? Well, they can make the connection because they're there every day. They see the fire burning. They see the sacrifice. And Jesus loving his enemies all the way till he takes his last breath. We read and don't connect. We read and don't see. Next. Satan. We know in this altar. Brazen. My pastor said he bankrupt heaven for you and me.
Yes.
You will never get it till you get that. You're going to get it today. Because I'm going to show you what costs. The altar of labor, the feet, the door, gird about your loins with the belt of truth. Right? A breastplate of righteousness. Right? A shield of faith. Our faith is in what Christ had done. Sword of the Spirit. Listen to me what I'm telling you. And put on your head the helmet of salvation. When they set the tabernacle up, what did they do in Israel when they set it up? They set the armies of Israel up around it.
Yes.
600,000 men. Six is the number of man. It was an army. They had weapons. It represents the armor of God.
Yes.
Wow. We haven't left this to even begin to come in here yet. Because only when you understand this will God call you in and start talking to you, start revealing things to you. True worshipers worship Him in spirit and in truth. True worship. When you understand the price that was paid for you, do you really understand it? I'm going to show it to you. And I ask the Lord to help me. Just show me a little part where I can reveal it to the people. Because my life was not changed. I was in church my whole life. Until I was 30 years old, I wasn't changed. When I finally got it, the debt that was paid for me, I saw it, I realized it, that I could not pay it. There's even more to that in that explanation. Because unless you're in the temple and you understand the temple and all of this stuff, what they're seeing every day, what He's ministering in front of, blood everywhere, guts all over the place. We don't even want to kill nothing anymore. Hey Adam, you know why your son killed your other son? Because of you. Because you didn't listen to God. You allowed sin to come in the world. You know why the guy down the street married, took the wife or killed the other guy? Adam, because of you. Why were you disobedient? Adam bore the weight of the world, the corruption of man, because Jesus was going to carry that curse. When He sinned, the ground brought forth the thorns that was placed on His head. The curse. Curse of the world. Listen to this. Let me tell you real quick about an altar. There are many altars and labors in the Bible. We just uploaded last week's message. If you didn't see it, you need to catch it. What is it? I'm going to talk about the true pattern for the church, the altar and the labors in the Bible and their meanings. I did that last week. What is a true sacrifice? The temple institutes meaning of a sacrifice. And let me read it to you. Boy, you talk about firing me up. Listen what they said. And this is incorrect. So I'm going to give you the incorrect interpretation of exactly what they did in Jesus' day. I got the Temple Institute book. They rebuilding the temple model by. I was there. I saw the pieces. This is their institution of what they say a sacrifice is. And it is wrong. Let's read it. Sacrifice is mentioned 340 times in the Bible. 340 times. About 8 different meanings of what a sacrifice is. They picked one place in the Bible of sacrifice and changed everything because of Jesus. Listen. The altar, a place of sacrifice, it is. If we stop to consider, this is the Jewish Institute This is what they say. If we stop to consider the English word for sacrifice, we will see that there is a conceptual gap which may help to account for somewhat the misunderstanding of it. A sacrifice is commonly defined as a presentation of an appeasing gift to a deity. Also, it has been described as giving something up of value in order to obtain or save something else. Oh yeah, Jesus gave up his life to save you and me. They denoted that. Watch. I'm not mad, I'm just pumped. I was going to read this to the church, to my people here. I wrote it directly from the Temple Institute. When I got to church, the Lord told me, go look at it. Go get your Hebrew Strongs. Go look at it before you give it. And I know why. This is amazing, because it led to what's happening right now. Watch this. The Hebrew term for sacrifice, however, denotes something altogether different. So it's not about laying down your life. Right? It's the Hebrew word korban. Wrong! If I could say. X doesn't mark this spot. The Hebrew word is korban. I'm going to read you the only place in the New Testament that the word, the Greek word, korban is mentioned.
Right.
I'm going to read it to you and see what Jesus says. Son! My God is awesome! Listen to the Spirit. Korban is derived from the Hebrew root meaning to draw near. Okay. But they denoted what sacrifice really means, and they said this is what it's really talking about with sacrifice. It means to draw near. I was like, wow, when I read it, I was pumped. Or to establish a close relationship with. So this is what I wrote after I read that. I'm reading my notes straight to you. So with this true meaning of what sacrifice meant, we can understand how we have been called to lay down our life a living sacrifice so we can draw near to Him.
Right.
And I'm like, man, that sounds great. It does. It is true. That is true. Right? And then it says, and then they put, I put dot, 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 because that's me. Temple sacrifice did not mean giving up or losing something of value. Listen what they're saying. This is them. Temple sacrifice did not mean giving up or losing something of value. It means to be able to draw closer to the one you love.
Yeah.
By giving money! That's not me. That's not, I'm not saying that. That's what the Temple Institute's red book I purchased from Israel says.
I confirm it, I've been studying that.
That's crazy. To give an offering to draw near.
Oh.
What? Are you crazy? It's only by blood.
Right.
That's why Jesus went in there and flipped over the money changers' tables.
Yeah.
Yes.
The priest who with the altar and laver dealt with the flesh and the cleaning process. They were to assist the people and they were to assist the people that were there in sacrifice. Their job was to help them draw near. Oh, really? Hey man, I heard you got that big fat check. Kick some over to. You want to get closer to God? Give some to the pastor.
Yeah,
God, just throw you out last week, bro.
Man. Wrong.
Amen.
Wrong. Listen to this. The Jews used this tradition, and I'm going to read it to you. The Jews used this as a tradition in giving of the temple treasury so that they could have privilege, they told them, you could have privilege to draw near. But the only way that we can see that we can draw near is by the blood. Jesus rebuked them.
Hallelujah.
In Mark chapter 7, verse 11, the only place that it's mentioned in the Berit HaDashah, that's the New Testament. So let's see what he said. And then I want to share something with you. Listen to this. Mark 7, 11. It's mentioned one time.
You like
that's a good mother-in-law.
That's okay. Funny right there.
Mark 7, 11. Check this out. I want to read into it. Jesus, he answered and said unto them, Mark 7, verse 6, unto them, well has Isaiah prophesied of you, you hypocrites. Man, that ain't even a good start, son. We ain't even got to 11 yet. Listen. As it is written, these people honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me.
Wow.
I think I remember somebody in Isaiah taking the coals from the altar and having it placed on his lips. Who will I send? Right? Isaiah 6. Howbeit in vain they do worship me. Wow. Teaching for the doctrines and the commandments of men. For laying aside the commandment of God, you hold on to the traditions of men. He's right there in the temple, people.
Yeah.
He's right there in the temple, watching them bring all these big offerings and everything. And he says, as the washing of pots and cups, that's what they had to do there, and many other such things like you do. And he said unto them, full well you reject the commandment of God, that ye may keep your tradition. For Moses said, to honor your father and mother, and whosoever curses his father and mother, let him die the death. That word honor is take care of them when they're old.
Right.
Take care of daddy. I take care of mama. I take care of mama.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it means right there. Take care of them when they're old. They change your diaper, you have to change their diaper,
yeah,
man. Watch this. Amen. Yeah, you gave it to me. I'm about to give it back to you now, boy. Watch this. And he says, verse 11, but you say, now remember that you take care of your family with your mama when they get old. You have to pay for diapers. You have to pay, use your money. Listen to what he says. But you say, if a man shall say to his father and mother, it is Corban, an offering unto God. That is to say, a gift. By whatsoever thou mightest be profited by, then you're free and you don't have to take care of your mother and your father. They call that sacrifice Corban. By you giving your money to the priest, you can draw nearer to God. It doesn't matter. You don't have to take care of your mother and father. The priest says, that's Corban. Are you crazy? The Temple Institute took one place in the Bible, and it's actually derived from Leviticus 27:11. So let's see what this is really about. Leviticus 27:11. The only other place in the entire Bible that it's written. Leviticus 27. This was crazy. Is it 27:11? Let me look at my Bible real quick. Is it 27:11? Hold on. I got it wrote down here. I'm going to find it. Just give me a sec. Leviticus chapter 27, verse 11. Leviticus 27, 11. Check this out. This is crazy. 27, the consecration of animals. That's what it starts off in verse 9. And I'm going to read into it so you see what it is. And if a beast, this is Levitical law, the Levites. And if a beast whereof a man bring an offering unto the Lord, all that any man giveth of such unto the Lord shall be holy. Right? But it's got to be without blemish. Right. He shall not alter it nor change it. A good for a bad, or a bad for a good. And if he shall change, and if he shall at all change beast for beast, then it and the exchange thereof shall be holy. And if it be any unclean beast. So if you're bringing something to God and it's unclean, watch this. Watch this. This is the word Corban. Here it is, the Greek, it's C-O-K-O-R-B-A-N. Here it's Q-O-R-B-A-N. And I know you're going to check it out. And if it be any unclean beast, of which they do not offer a sacrifice unto the Lord, then he shall present the beast before the priest. So that means, if you got something that God is not going to accept, because it may be defiled or something, unclean, a spot, you could bring it to the priest and say, look, this is all I got. Watch. And the priest shall value it, whether it be good or bad, as thou valuest it, who art the priest, they shall do it. But if he will at all redeem it, then he shall add it a fifth part thereof unto the estimation, meaning, if you bring an offering and the priest knows it's unclean, but he likes it, he can add a fifth part. He'll accept it,
yeah.
But it's his,
yeah.
And not God's.
Right.
Oh, no.
That's where the money came in.
Yeah.
That's where the money came in.
Wow.
Unclean. The priest saw it with his eyes. Oh, it's fine, but it's got a blemish. But I want it.
Oh, covet. Covet.
Man, let me get to the root of everything today.
Oh,
I want to tell you something. I'm going to end with this. I'm going to end with this. I want you to hear something. Because of time, listen to this. I wasn't 30 years old until I was 30 years old that I truly met the Lord. I met him in a way that he totally changed my life. I told my wife and I told my mom, there is no going back. There's a lot to it. There's a lot that I've done. And Jesus asked Peter, to whom? Who loves more? One who has been forgiven of much, or one who has been forgiven of little? Peter said, much. I've been forgiven of much. When God opened my eyes and showed me my debt and showed me Jesus Christ, showed me the sacrifice because of the way I study and the path he took me down. I told the Lord, if this is all you're about, if this is what church is about, I don't have nothing to do with it or you. I'm done. And the Lord began to reveal himself to me. And this is the only way you'll ever be changed. Because if you don't get this, it don't matter how many times you walk down the altar, it don't matter. Because I love him with my heart. I was teaching on the brazen altar in a laver, and I was about to go into the holy place when God brought me across that word, Corbin and sacrifice, last week, and told me to go look at it. And he did it for a reason, because what's more important in all of these pieces is the sacrifice. Before we can go any further, you have to understand the sacrifice. I remember when God revealed the sacrifice that was made for me. It wasn't until years later that I got an understanding of the sacrifice that my wife made for me. Remember, the Lord told me, because if you don't understand the sacrifice, you'll never offer your best. You'll never, ever offer your best, and it'll never reach God. But when you understand the sacrifice, the Lord had spoke to me and he told me, I want you to clean out your house. I want you to clean every room, every closet, every drawer, all the way into the attic. I want you to clean out the house. I'm not getting into my past. I sacrificed and believed him. I never did get that or understand that sacrifice that she made because of all the things that we had been through. So one day, years later, and I'll tell you, 25 years ago, whatever it was, my wife sold her original wedding band that I had gotten for her, pawned it, sold it at a jewelry place to make provision for my daughter at the time. And I was doing my own thing, running and drugging and all kind of stuff. Just running from God. The Lord moved us up to Mississippi to get away. I said, Lord, if you want this marriage to work, you need to get me out of Chalmette, move us to Mississippi. The Lord speaks to me and says, I want you to clean your house. This is after God done touched me. I'm talking now, I moved from Chalmette 1995, April of 95, now it's 2011. So God done downloaded all of this, done built all the tabernacle, you know, living for Jesus. I mean, just, you know, not just great, everything is, you know. And the Lord tells me, I want you to clean out your house. So I clean my house out. So at the very time, my wife has got to go have surgery. And for the first time, God shows me the sacrifice that she made for me. She could have moved on. And I saw for the first time what I did. God forgave me. But I didn't see the sacrifice that was laid down here for me. I'm going through the attic and I'm reading letters of just, and it's just, I'm seeing something I never saw before, and God just starts just downloading on me, and he tells me, I get everything cleaned out, and I gotta, you know, I'm done, I'm pulling everything out, and the Lord says, no, shop vac the attic. So I get the shop vac. I'm like, why shop vac it? You know what I mean? I get up there in the attic, and I stick this shop vac under plywood that's in the attic, and I'm shop vacing everything because the Lord said clean it. When I pull the shop vac out, there's this little thing caught on the front of the shop vac. I mean, a little folded piece of paper. Long story short, the place she was working at, this is a jewelry receipt from where she was working at, where she sold the ring 22 years earlier. And the Lord told me, I want you to have the ring remade. Now, for the first time, I understood, and I'm going to connect this back to the Lord. For the first time, I was getting the understanding and seeing the sacrifice that she had made, and it cost her. How would you feel if your wife said to you, I don't care who you've been sleeping with, my bed is always open to you? Is that a sacrifice? That's a sacrifice, son. I didn't see none of that at first. When the Lord starts and he tells me to have the ring remade, I was wearing on something, my daddy had died in 2009. And, come here, brother. This pendant that's around his neck, I wanted to have the ring remade, but the ring costs a lot of money. I took this off my daddy's neck when he died. My daddy had this made for my mom. My mom didn't wear it. My daddy wore it, and there's a long story with it. But when my daddy died, it came to me. It was mine. Very precious to me. When I wanted to get her ring made, I didn't have any money. None. The Lord said, are you willing to sacrifice? I sold my tractor. I sold my cow. $1,000 tractor, $1,300 cow. To do whatever I could. And I went and seen a jeweler to see what that ring was going to cost. But I was short. And the Lord said, will you sacrifice what's on your neck? And I said, yes. And I went in and I gave that man that piece of jewelry right there. And I said, here, this ought to pay for it. I know it. That was a sacrifice of love.
Yeah.
That now would be accepted. A sacrifice of love. That's the only thing. That means you and I laying our life down.
Right.
Really. And the highest form that we can worship him is just by being obedient to him. That's it. The highest form of worship. You want to worship him? Just be obedient to him.
That's right.
Yeah. Just love him. Be obedient. Needless to say, the man couldn't take it.
It says Jesus.
It says Jesus on it. It's got 39 diamonds in it. He took 39 lashes. My wife, when she found out, was like, she didn't know till later. The guy didn't, he couldn't melt it. He couldn't, he called Chloe, my daughter, and said, look, your daddy just did something. I can't touch this. Needless to say, you can go sit down. They got it back. Then God asks me again, tells me to give it to my brother. right? Because it's what he just, it's a sacrifice. Because I loved him and God told me to do it, it was given. I want to tell you something. You really don't know what a sacrifice is until you've been tested through it. And a true sacrifice will cost you. My wife, come here, baby. My wife, after being married for some years, came to me and told me that she had ran credit cards up to over $10,000. And when I found out,
I couldn't juggle it anymore.
She couldn't juggle it. She couldn't handle it. She couldn't pay the debt. When I found out about it, I was mad. And the Lord told me, I forgave you. Yeah. I'm his bride. When the Lord got a hold of me, I said, you know what? It's okay. It costs me. It cost me. But I did it because I loved her. Now watch. If Donald Trump would have paid her debt, would she have thought anything of it? He's a rich man. But because she knew the price that I had to pay, what?
I'm choked up.
So tell me, watch, how did you feel?
Humbled, grateful, broken, and release.
Release. When you realize the debt that it cost to take what we've done, because we're not in the temple setting, we don't see it. We don't understand it. But you know what? The first thing she felt was release. That's exactly what Jesus Christ wanted for you and me. Yes.
You know what else was in it too? I had prepared myself all day to received the so-called wrath of God. You know what I mean? I was prepared, and rightfully so, deserved anything he would have dished out, you know, with to the point hitting me. That's not acceptable, but which he'd never do. But you understand what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Any tongue lashing I would have got, I knew I totally deserved it. Totally deserved it. And he didn't do what I deserved, and that's what broke me. Because he just loved me.
Yeah.
And you know what? All of that happened last week with the word Corbin. So God, at this point in teaching about the brazen altar and labor, could bring back so that we can have an understanding. And I ask the Lord, help me to be able to convey what a real sacrifice is. And listen to me. A real sacrifice costs.
Yes, it does.
When you understand the cost, man, you understand the worship. Brother, go up there and sing that song. the last one you just sang. You begin to look at songs in worship different. You understand it. You find me worshiping, you find me in thanksgiving, you find me on my knees. Man, that's where it's at. That is the worship that he accepts. That's the only sacrifice that is then brought from here, because it's true and real and brought in and now dumped on the altar of incense, and it goes up to the Lord as a sweet savior.
Yeah.
Now, those who worship me in spirit and in truth. When you understand that, there ain't no going back. There's nothing. He bankrupted heaven. When we deserve the wrath of God, he said, I love you and I forgive you. Wow. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray, Lord, that we'll all come to the knowledge and a revelation of what you have actually done for us, Father.
Yes.
And Father, I want to thank you for the sacrifice that you made for me.
Yes.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you.